That practically means you, Christian, share the gospel with a house key. That practically means you, Christian, share the gospel with an invitation that, hey, you know what? Christmas, Easter, Thanksgiving, my house, there's no question about where you're going to spend your birthday. You're my brother. You're part of a family.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive. I'm John Fuller, and welcome to another Best of 2019 episode of Focus on the Family, featuring Focus president and author Jim Daly.
John, it's absolutely amazing how God works, often in ways that we can't even imagine. Today we're going to hear about a simple ministry strategy that each one of us can do that will transform lives. It's called hospitality. And our guest today experienced this firsthand. Years ago, Dr. Rosaria Butterfield was about as far away from God as anyone could be. She thought Christians were the enemy, and she was happy with her life as a lesbian and feminist, and as an outspoken advocate for LGBTQ rights. But God orchestrated something impossible. A Christian couple, Ken and Floy Smith, invited Rosaria into their home, and through their friendship, she experienced a radical transformation and eventually gave her life to Jesus Christ. And today, Rosaria is a pastor's wife, a homeschooling mom, and she has a powerful message about how all of us can have that same amazing impact through hospitality that Ken and Floy had in her life.
Yeah, Jim, this is a great time of year for this kind of a message, and we hope that you will be challenged and a little bit convicted by what Dr. Butterfield has. She's written a book called The Gospel Comes with a House Key, Practicing Radically Ordinary Hospitality in Our Post-Christian World. And here now is how we began the conversation with Dr. Butterfield on this Best of 2019 episode.
Rosaria, welcome back to Focus on the Family.
Oh, thank you so much. It's always an honor and privilege to be here with you.
It's just good to see you. My heart is leaping inside because it's so much fun. I just love the way you think and what God has done with your life. And what a background. And we're not going to cover all that ground. We're getting into a new direction today. But I so appreciate what the hand of God has done in you. In
Amen.
Your husband, in your family.
Praise God.
And it's a powerful testimony. In fact, if the listeners missed it, you can get it through Focus
on the
Family.
We'll link over to the download, yes.
Because it is something that you should share with friends. It's one of those amazing stories of God's work in someone's life. Help us understand why you are so passionate about hospitality. You know, we read that in Scripture and we think, be kind, be joyful, be hospitable. Okay, and we keep moving.
But it is a key
to unlocking the heart of especially non-believers.
It is. And it's also connected to what it means to be a radically converted person in this post-Christian world.
Why?
Here's why. When I share with people what Ken and Floy Smith did for me in my conversion process. Now, I don't believe that I'm discipled into conversion. I don't believe that, you know, it was a casserole that brought me to faith. It was it was the Spirit of God.
Yeah, this is
which
love.
Is a supernatural, you know, the power of heaven coming down to save a sinner like me. But the highway that traveled on was Ken and Floy Smith's tireless Christian hospitality. I was in their home at least weekly for 2 years. And while in their home, I would argue with them. And after I would argue with them, I would go back to campus where I was a professor at Syracuse, and I would demean them. I would mock them. And I would go back the next week and do it again.
Let me ask you this. Why did you say yes? I mean, what?
Well, because I was doing research on a book for the religious right, and I thought of Ken Smith as my unpaid research assistant.
So this came with a little bit of an undercurrent.
An agenda.
Okay.
I mean, if you think, you know, if I thought evangelical Christians had an agenda, believe me, as a gay rights activist, I had a bigger one, in my opinion.
Right.
And I thought I had the winning one.
So you said yes, you go to the home.
And week after week, it's the same thing. Lots of people come in, good food, simple food, sort of like how I cook, simple food, but plenty of it. People come in, they talk, then at a certain point, the Bible's open, the Psalter's open. They sing the Psalms exclusively, four-part harmony. The aesthetic beauty of the Psalms was compelling to me, and the words, quite frankly, were disgusting. I don't know what else
at the
to
time,
say.
Right.
To me at the time, absolutely. And after years and years of that, and I talk about this elsewhere, something happened. The Bible got to be bigger inside me than I. And that's what changed. And when I came to Christ, I did not stop feeling like a lesbian, but I knew Jesus was who he said he was.
Yeah. To paint that picture a little more fully, I mean, you even referred to their home as the cult house.
Oh, I did,
probably
yeah.
to your students.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And the reason I'm asking, especially to my lover
at the time, you know, because she'd be like, what are you doing again? Oh, I'm warming up my vocal cords. Like, that was just the most common thing for me to do, you know.
So,
but we were going to sing.
Yeah, and the challenge.
Which was compelling.
Yeah, and the challenge there is this tension you had to feel.
Yes.
Between your life and what it was then as a sinner not drawing or knowing God.
Right.
And then this odd attraction
yes.
to what this
yeah,
couple.
Yeah, very odd.
Yeah.
Disarmingly
odd. How long
odd
did that process
attraction.
Take before you said, Lord, I
two
get
years.
It. It was 2 years.
It was 2 years.
Let me just turn to the listeners again, because this is critical. Think of somebody in your life that you think is so beyond God's reach, they could never become a Christian. And start praying for them. Start inviting them mm-hmm. over, right? I mean, that's the thing.
Right.
Why? Let me ask you this question, Rosaria. Why do we stumble with that simple idea?
Well, because I think the spiritual warfare that we experience is it's disarming to us, and it's unusual. And instead, my invitation is for Christians to just relax and step into the conflict. But I think that we want it to be nice. We want to have a nice dinner. We want, you know, we want the table settings to match. We don't want the cat to have a hairball as soon as the guests come in. You know, we want, and we certainly don't want our guests to be potentially offended. We don't want our guests to offend us. We have lots of anxiety, and this is spiritual warfare. And instead, I think what we need to do is what Ken and Floyd Smith did. They said, you know what? If we're going to be agents of grace, then we need to get close enough to the stranger to put the hand of the stranger into the hand of the Savior. And you know what? Somebody here is going to get hurt.
Yeah.
May God be given all the glory.
Yeah, and I love the idea that you're, what's the right way to say this? You're deconstructing the complexity of doing something
like
this. It doesn't have to be something
And this
something
doesn't
huge.
Happen in La La Land. Guess what?
Right.
Guess what? You know, 20 years ago, people could sit together at the same table even though they voted differently. Today, we're told that's impossible. A good question is why? And those are some of the things that I try to unpack in this book and some of the practices that I think are necessary. But here's what I know. As I've shared with people my testimony, I have so many people just walk away rich young ruler style.
Mm.
And they say, wow, they're super Christians. I could never do that. And I'm here to say we are all called to set our boundaries a little differently.
Yeah.
In the past, we've set them according to our checkbook and according to our calendar. In a post-Christian world, we're called to set them according to the blood of Christ. Ken and Floyd Smith were just a little ahead of the game.
Yeah, but it's where we should all be. And that's why I like the subtitle of your book, which is Radically Ordinary mm-hmm. Hospitality. Mm-hmm. Describe what that looks like day to day.
Well, day to day, it means two things. First of all, conceptually, it means always looking at the objective of the Christian life, the purpose, your purpose for being here. And that is to seek strangers, and seek them you must. They don't actually fall from the sky. To seek strangers and make them neighbors and embrace neighbors, praying that God would make them family of God. Mm. So that's conceptually the journey. And once you cross those thresholds, everything changes. When you cross the threshold between stranger and neighbor, you never go back to stranger. The bridge is burned down. You can't go back there. And when you cross the bridge from neighbor to family of God, that doesn't, you can't go back either.
Yeah.
And so that's conceptually what it means. And what it means practically is that for the last 17 years of marriage, Kent and I have just done this thing that we thought was normal. But we, you know, we are in the world, so we know that Christians don't think it is.
Right.
And so we think of this book as our coming out party, if you will. When Kent and I got married, we were the only believers in our extended families. That means that we were lonely people.
Yeah.
And our commitment to family of God meant that we believed that our home was a place where a family of God gathers, not by invitation only, but organically and regularly. So we started practicing daily hospitality with our family of God from the very beginning of our marriage. One of the nice little old ladies in the church had bought us one of those little guest books that you fill out. Well, after 4 months of marriage, we had filled it up entirely. And we looked at each other and said, we're going to throw this sucker away.
Get a new one.
No, we're never going to get a new one because we're going to have God keep these tallies.
Oh, wow.
Because there's something about keeping these tallies that is going to spook us. Because we were noticing then a crisis of loneliness in the church. And, you know, part of how the post-Christian world became a post-Christian world is it the secular world capitalized on some real sin issues in our church. I'm not talking right now about sexuality.
Right.
I'm talking about cold hearts.
Right.
I'm talking about the willingness to allow crushing loneliness to reside in the hearts of the people who are our fellows, you know, our fellow shoulder rubbers in the pews.
Right.
And why? Well, because it was a sin that just went under the radar. We started to feel that our time was our own, that our homes were our castles, and that really the scriptural command that the gospel would come with a hundredfold practical, nurturing connections within the family of God. And that's in Mark chapter 10. We might get to that on this in this conversation. And we started to see that as somebody else's business. We started to prefer programs over relationships. And we looked at the singles in our church as people who needed to be fixed or fixed up.
Yeah.
And those are sins that we are revisiting in this post-Christian world.
Well, I so appreciate that, the way we started the program, that heart for truth and understanding. And I think that's true. When we really dissect where we're at, we're in a cold place. We have automatic garage door openers. I would assume that, like me, I know some of our neighbors. I don't know all our neighbors. And even when I'm in, you know, Christian company, many people don't know any neighbor. And I think that's an indication of what you're talking about, this, you know, it sounds harsh, but that cold-heartedness that we don't really care. The other thing is just with modernity, you have so many things pulling at your time. You know, we're busy people, and we make excuses that we're busy people. And therefore, we don't have time for hospitality and getting to know the people around us. And that's really an error, isn't it? Because an old book, I think Paul Tripp is the author, Instruments in the Hands of God.
Love that book.
There's a line in there that caught me for today's program, and that is, our relationships belong to God.
That's right.
Think of that. That our relationships belong to God, and it's how we nurture them and how we steward them that is important to Him, the Heavenly Father. When you start looking at it from that perspective, wow, that's a lot of responsibility.
Right, absolutely. And I would say, in addition to modernity creating a kind of self-absorption, the idea that somehow I'm really busy. And that
I'm guilty of that.
I'm really busy doing important things. And maybe I should have a blog in my own name. I mean, can I just tell you that I think the Puritans would call that sin? I really do. And maybe you all have blogs in your names. And so you're just going to be like, Rosaria, I can't believe you nailed me.
But
I'm going to plead blog. I'm going to plead the fifth. I never do anything with it, but I have.
But speak to our hearts. Tell us.
We're open.
Yeah. I mean, in modernity, the idea was it was the self-autonomous individual. Finding meaning in nothing but himself.
That's the American creed.
But now we're at even a more dangerous place because we've moved from modernity to post-modernity. And we are now in a place where we have the quote-unquote intersectional person finding purpose and meaning in nothing but victimhood.
Yeah, that's so true.
And, you know, that is damaging in a different way, but that's what makes it impossible today, or seemingly impossible. I argue in the book it's not impossible. You just have to have enough chutzpah to
like
move
that.
On with that. But the idea, you know, often Christians feel that, how can I talk to my neighbors who identify as lesbian when everything I say is hate speech? Well, here's how. you make sure that your relationship with that person is stronger than the words you're going to use.
Huh.
And how do you do that? Well, get off Facebook. Stop thinking that anybody really cares what you have to say on Twitter. and peel some potatoes. Put on a pot of coffee.
Invite them over.
And invite them over. And you know what? It's not efficient. We're talking about one person at a time.
Yeah. It's tough, but you're really hitting it. I want to highlight some of the critics that you've had in your church. I mean, because I think that's an important place to go, and that will be something that you face.
Sure, absolutely.
People that say, I just don't have people over. Maybe their personalities are more introverted. Mm-hmm, speak to the temperament issue, too, because this is hard to do for some people that aren't bent toward relationship in that way.
Right, right. And I would say, too, that everybody doesn't have to do this the same way. All right? So there are lots of things that you can do. And if you do what you do and you open your arms a little wider, you're going to find that you have a niche that I don't have. And if a couple of families in the church do it together, that means that you all can support another family in crisis. Mm. Now, all that means is that you have access to people in need. It doesn't mean you have to do anything. There are seasons of life when you can't. If you're a mom with small children, and let's face it, 7 o'clock is not the time you're having dinner with friends. That's bath time.
Right.
Is there a time during the day that you can open your home to other moms with small children? But make it explicitly gospel focused. I think this is the challenge. Christians need to do what you do, but realize that the gospel is not going to transmute by osmosis. So if you're having, lunch with people, how are you going to move from egg salad to eternity? Well, figure that out.
Ask good questions.
Ask good questions. But I'll tell you, in our house, it helps to have a routine already established.
Mm. Dr. Rosaria Butterfield is our guest on Focus on the Family, and we're talking about her book, The Gospel Comes with a House Key. And you can get copies of that, a CD, or a free download of our conversation at focusonthefamily.com/broadcast. And I want to ask you about that, because earlier you said, if Christians have an agenda, you had an agenda. All right, so go back to me. I'm inviting a neighbor over for coffee. Mm-hmm. I feel like I have to turn it to Jesus right now.
That's a great question. One of the reasons that we have found making open invitations to our neighbors so useful, one is I talk in the book about a crisis in our neighborhood that kind of conjured that up. But it became so useful to just say, Thursday night is neighbor night. Thursday night is soup and prayer. I put on pots of soup at 6. Come join us. Anybody's welcome. We put this out on the Nextdoor app. Invite 300 households. No kidding. And then at 7 o'clock, we're going to have a short Bible lesson, and we're going to sing a psalm, and we're going to pray. And you know what? First of all, neighbors already know what we're going to do.
So it's not a surprise.
It's not a surprise. And because we do this every single night, Kent has been leading family devotions every single night. At a certain point, the kids bring all the dishes up to the dishwasher, and they send the Bibles and the mugs of coffee and the salters down. And you know what? Sometimes neighbors say, hey, I gotta go. That's fine. But they don't always. But the reason for these open and regular invitations is this. Many of your neighbors, I might even say most, are afflicted with abuse and addiction. And that means that as noble as your invitation, Tuesday night at 7 might be, quite frankly, many of your neighbors do not know if they're going to be sober or safe that particular Tuesday. But, if it's regular, hey, we do this every week. One of those weeks, they will be ready. And so we turn it in this way, and it's a known reality. And we've had neighbors say, wow, is this some strange ritual you do? I don't care what you call it. But we're going to go there. And the reason is because we've just talked about heavy things. We've just talked about important things. And now we want Jesus to enter this conversation, not to stop the conversation, but to deepen it. And then you know what? We're going to come back and do this tomorrow. And we're going to do this the next day. So we don't have a one-time opportunity to talk to our neighbor. This is the problem, that people have very shallow understandings of the relationships that they are to create. I'm not talking about a shallow relationship with my neighbors. God never gets the address wrong. He gave me these neighbors. He appointed these relationships. And I'm going to build them for as long as He keeps me there. And so to spend a good amount of time listening is very important. I mean, how will you know what the gospel bridge is to your neighbor? Too often Christians think in false categories of personhood. They think, oh, there's got to be some special gospel for my neighbor who identifies as lesbian, or a different way of approaching the gospel for my neighbor who identifies as Muslim, or not. You know, I mean, a big question that Christians have to ask, this is a question Ken Smith asked me 20 years ago. Do you believe that is what is true determines what is ethical? Or do you believe that what is ethical will determine what is true? We are all image bearers of a holy God, every single person. I don't care what category you have slapped onto yourself. There's only a few that are going to survive eternity. We know the word of God will survive eternity, so we want to make sure that our neighbors who might never hear it elsewhere will hear it from us. But here's what we need to also remember. Life is hard. And some people have one cross to bear and others have 10. So rather than pretending that the Christian life is democratic, why don't we just work hard to roll up our sleeves and help carry some of those crosses? Mm-hmm. But we can't do it until we know what they are.
Well, and here's the issue with that. It's hard work.
Yes.
You know, and this scripture that comes to my mind, Rosaria, is, you know, do these good deeds so that they'll honor your Father in heaven. It doesn't say these good words.
That's right.
Do these good deeds, because through those deeds, someone's heart typically is opened. Even the most crusty of hearts
absolutely
is opened in that way, because they see what's real.
That's right.
When somebody's willing to do the word,
that's right.
It changes the relationship, doesn't it?
Yes. And what we're talking specifically about is the way table fellowship does that. That these aren't just good deeds of changing. I mean, it's good to change a tire, a flat tire. I personally don't know how to do that. So you
but
really
helping
don't want
neighbors.
To help,
and,
but helping
you know.
Neighbors, those are very good things. But to gather nightly at the table, that has the thumbprint of Jesus all over it. You know, have you ever wondered? I've often wondered in Luke 7 how it is that Mary, this woman of the streets, wanders into this dinner party, and the next thing you know, she's at Jesus' feet, oil, tears, loose hair. I mean, I've thrown a lot. I do hospitality every night. I've never had a party crasher like that. That's crazy, right? But what's also so amazing about it, I think it's amazing, is that it shows us how accessible that home was. And that home was accessible because these first century homes had a kind of outdoor, easy access porch, really.
Right.
And so one of the things that we've learned is that start by throwing parties in your front yard. You know,
draw people in.
Put the grill in the front yard. Put lots of tables and chairs out. Get people in the front yard. It's hard to cross.
Do about our attitude as Christians and the issue about our tongue and how we use our tongue. And I want to get into this, and I'm going to have you come back if you can. Mm-hmm. Let's come back next time, tomorrow, and continue the discussion.
Love
but this idea, I think it's partly born out of insecurity that we don't know enough to spiritually battle competently. And so we turn to this defensive posture when people knock us off our spot,
right,
and we attack verbally, which is utterly the wrong thing to do when you're talking
absolutely
to somebody with the gospel. I love Romans 2:4, which says, don't you know it's God's kindness that leads one to repentance.
Right.
I mean, this is what you're saying.
Right.
I often speak in front of audiences and I'll ask, who was beaten verbally, emotionally, or physically into the kingdom of God?
Right. Zero.
I've never had a hand go up.
No, absolutely.
Nobody has
will.
Said to me, I was so mistreated by those Christians that I decided to become one of them.
Right, absolutely.
It's always the other way.
That's
I
right.
saw such incredible love. They treated me with such kindness.
Right.
And yet it's a tool we don't readily use.
That's right. No, I think that's absolutely right. But I would also add to that, that those Christians were disarming.
Right.
I came to them with a sense that this is who I am. I came to them with a sense that I am a lesbian. That's what I said to Ken Smith, my first meeting. 2 years later, through his clear gospel witness and love, I came to realize that lesbian may very well be how I was, but it will never be who I am.
Which is
so
powerful.
He did not meet me where I was and leave me there. He met me where I was and took my hand and said, let's go talk to Jesus about this.
Yes.
That's how we concluded part one of our Best of 2019 conversation with Dr. Rosaria Butterfield as she talked about her book, The Gospel Comes with a House Key, Practicing Radically Ordinary Hospitality in Our Post-Christian World.
You know, Rosaria's message is so powerful. I really hope families are resonating with what she shared today. The last time we aired this program, a listener said, you hit it out of the park. She was so convicted by Rosaria's stories of inviting neighbors over to share the gospel with them. This listener promised to pray about how God might use her in the same way. And we even heard from a Christian family living in Bangladesh.
Oh my.
And they told us that they would sing worship songs in their home. And this family was visited by a Muslim neighbor who asked if they could open their window so she could hear the song more clearly. That led to an opportunity to talk about Jesus. Well, that is why Focus on the Family is here, to help you grow bold in your faith and spread the good news about Jesus Christ. Rosaria's book, The Gospel Comes with a House Key, will help you do exactly that. And if you can send a gift of any amount to support the work at Focus on the Family, we'll put a copy into your hands as our way of saying thank you.
And you can do that either in a monthly pledge or a one-time gift. Anything you can donate to Focus today really helps. And you can contribute by clicking on the link on your screen. On behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for joining us for this best of episode of Focus on the Family. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back as we once again help you and your family thrive in Christ.